gentlemen. Welcome to the Legal Revolution 2017, and thank you all for being part of this groundbreaking event. Some of you might already know me because I'm part of the organization team. My name is Ornella Gallon, and I work as an associate at Brandhof Obermüller Partner. It is my great pleasure to guide you through the day and to introduce our great speakers and panelists to you. Speaking of which, the first speaker I would like to introduce to you is Professor Heribert Anzinger. He is Chair of Commercial Law and Tax Law at the University of Ulm. It is an honor for us to welcome him as one of our speakers. Professor Anzinger will treat the topic of smart contracts and blockchains with regard to business models, legal challenges, and the impact on the legal market. Let's give him a warm welcome.
So thank you, Ms. Gallum, for your kind introduction. Smart contracts and blockchain technologies are promising legal tech in a broad sense of the word. A wide range of new business models is being discussed. Some are predicted to have significant impact on the law. Recently, a German scientific journal, which is otherwise devoted to data protection law and data security, published a special issue of blockchain and its business models. And these days, the newly founded Blockchain Federal Association published a policy paper on the opportunities and challenges of a new digital infrastructure for Germany. It stressed the importance of those new technologies. Contracting out contract law is also seen as a chance for developing countries, as they might all allow importing trust into low trust societies electronically. But there are not only songs of praise for the promises of the new technologies. Some people warn against the blockchain hype and disqualify smart contracts as neither smart nor contracts. Some call the Bitcoin blockchain a Ponzi, or all cryptocurrencies a pyramid scheme, while distributed ledgers conceal organized irresponsibility. Depending on the perspective and confidence in the degree of abstraction of the German civil law system, different regulatory needs are identified. A lot of things are still unclear. It starts with simple and basic questions. What is the difference between a smart contract and gumball machines? Are smart contracts intelligent, self-executing contracts on which new legal forms can be created? What are they useful for? Which platforms will prevail? What are the challenges for the design of electronic contracts? And where is the legislator required? And last not least, what might be the impact on the legal market? With this lecture, I would like to present you an excerpt from the current spectrum of opinions. I will not be able to discuss all aspects in the next 30 minutes, but I would like to present some thesis for the following discussion. My talk is divided into four parts. First, I want to explore the essence of smart contract and blockchain with you. Time will not be enough for deep insights into technology. Then some current business models will be outlined. This can be followed by legal questions and the need for regulation. Finally, potential effects on the legal services market will be examined. The idea of smart contracts, I understand, as a framework of trustworthy computations with untrusted parties sounds new, but it might celebrate its 20th anniversary this year. In 1999, Nick Szabo, a computer scientist, legal scholar, and cryptographer, published this fundamental paper of the God principles and coined the term smart contracts. A first concept paper is said to have been published in 1997. In 1998, Nick Szabo presented his idea for a decentralized digital currency called BitGold. Today, it is considered a direct preliminary step to Bitcoin, which is a use case for smart contracts, also a very simple one. According to Nick Szabo, smart contracts are computer protocols intended to facilitate, verify, or enforce the negotiation or performance of a contract. In the context of German law, 20 years later, smart contracts are defined in a very similar way. by one of the most committed pioneers, Mark Kaulatz. According to him, a smart contract is a software that steers, controls, and or documents legally relevant actions, particularly an actual exchange of services, as a function of digitally verifiable events, with the help of which it is also possible to conclude real contracts and or contracts under the law of obligations. We'll have to discuss if that means that a smart contract is code as law or a smart contract is chain code as software. Before that, we shall remember that it has been the mystical Satoshi Nakamoto who revived the idea of smart contracts with his paper Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system, in 2008. The importance of this invention was described by web browser pioneer and internet investor Mark Andreessen with a famous quote, which allows a perfect transfer to the following slide. Oh my God, this is it. This is the big breakthrough. This is the thing we've been waiting for. He solved all the problems. Whoever he is should get the Nobel Prize. He is a genius. This is the thing. Mark Andreessen had not gumball machines in his mind when with these sentences. He meant the distributed trust network that the internet always needed and never had. But gumball machines allow some thoughts on the essence of smart contracts. In Germany, gumball machines are not round but square, and we all remember them from our school days. They have a lot in common with smart contracts. They automate the conclusion of self-executing contracts. And there is no need to have confidence in a person's compliance with the contract. Of course, as children, we had little faith in that technology. The vending machines were often stuck, and the bakery around the corner was much more reliable. The vending machines, but this essence of smart contracts is described as, it is about the shift of trust, in people to trust in technology and its designers. The shift of trust in people to trust in technology and its designers. The first vending machines are said to have offered books and served to circumvent censorship. Their operators hoped that a vending machine could not be prosecuted. Unfortunately, the jurisprudence came to the conclusion at an early stage that the real seller is not the vending machine, but the person setting it up. The vending machine offers an offer to everyone on condition that goods are in stock and the vending machine is fully functional and properly operated. The gumball machine leads to the automated conclusion of a contract, implicitly due to the operation of the mechanics. The contract is also executed by the same mechanism. The chewing gum is delivered step by step against the insertion of a coin. Neither a letter of credit nor a bank guarantee is required for security. Trust in technology is sufficient. My second example deals with the automated conclusion of self-executing rental contracts. In most of the public toilets, there is no longer any staff to whom a fee could be paid. Access is secured by turnstiles. Notably, no separate written contract must be concluded before the machine can be operated at the turnstile. The contents of the contract are determined by the circumstances, expectations, and the machine. On my picture, even a signboard indicates important functions. There are no two levels where contract conclusion and automated execution need to be separated. In my third example, the content of the contract is no longer so easily accessible from the circumstances. It is about a loan agreement which stipulates that the use of the financed vehicle should no longer be possible if the loan installments are not paid. Could the source code be suitable content of a contract offer that could be legally accepted? That example leads to the question of the contract language, the conclusion of the contract, and the law of the general terms and conditions. Basically, however, I think that this simple source code could still be easily understood with a suitable legend. It also leaves the machine no room for discretion. So this code might be suitable content of a contract and might be direct object of a legal binding declaration of interest. We'll come back to that later.
Automated execution requires a connection to the reality of life. Smart contracts must be able to influence the reality. Therefore, they presuppose that the contractual performance can be enforced digitally and that the contractual conditions are limited to events which can be reproduced digitally. This is easy if only digital code, if only digital goods are to be handed over, or if rights to use tangible assets are to be granted and remunerated. For other areas, however, the use of smart contracts is not excluded. Aids, devices can also be used to digitize or to influence the reality. A frequently cited example is the start interrupter, which is more common in US than in Europe. In the event of default in performance, Leistungsstörungen, immediate execution of the resulting claims is possible through smart contracts. Default and other damages can be offset against the purchase price. Such a functionality increases the complexity of the contracts, but can be implemented. However, the prerequisite for this is that the events that cause a performance disturbance can be mapped digitally. This is conceivable for application in the area of sharing economy and license management. If smart contracts can be contracts, the next question is whether they can also be intelligent smart contracts or a type of artificial intelligence. They are not a type of artificial intelligence, but they might include AI. However, they could dynamically link to a program library that contains the relevant legal framework conditions. They could also automate contract adjustments in order to reflect the most favorable tax arrangements for tax changes. Finally, they could contain elements of artificial intelligence. It is conceivable to have a face, emotion, and speech recognition system that is supposed to set the most favorable conditions in automated contract negotiations. In summary, smart contracts can be both stupidly and intelligently constructed. The UK government praises smart contracts for ensuring regulatory compliance, product traceability, and counterfeiting in many sectors. As smart contracts are ultimately software, they can also be agreed between machines. For example, electric vehicles could be able to buy electricity at charging stations on their own. It is not only possible to program bilateral contracts under the law of obligations, but also articles of association. This is an interesting development for comparative law research. Computer scientists have developed their own forms of company without recognition of the legal reality. Without awareness even of the existence of company law, they have given thought to principles of raising capital, corporate governance, and the protection of minorities, and have developed an electronic legal entity called the DAO. Probably none of the new contract types combines such a potential than the DAO. In German law, the conflict of law question immediately arises as to the actual seat of administration and the classification in German company law. From a German perspective, a DAO with a German actual seat of administration, as well as any contract in the blockchain, can only be connected with an unregistered, non-legal association. The current technology of decentralized smart contracts is based on the Bitcoin blockchain. It is linked to the Satoshi's colored coins. Even the colored coin protocol of the Bitcoin blockchain, a number of simple contracts can be represented. The Bitcoin scripting language allows, for example, multilateral conditional transactions. A third party may be appointed as arbitrator, and in the event of a default in performance, a contract may also be rescinded. However, the Bitcoin scripting language is not complete. It does not allow loops. This deficit eliminates the Ethereum blockchain. It is based on the blockchain protocol of Satoshi Nakamoto, but extends it by a Turing-complete programming environment that allows programs of any complexity. The code of smart contracts runs in a coordinated way on all computers forming the Ethereum peer-to-peer network. There's not one server which is running Ethereum. Together, they build the Ethereum virtual machine. This world computer is considered to be fault-tolerant, fail-safe, and censorship-resistant. Solidity is the most widely used scripting language for which compilers are available to generate Ethereum bytecode. Solidity was criticized for security issues, it's hard to validate scripting language, and permissiveness. This criticism hits the older Python dialect, Serpent, even harder. A younger language called Viper is not yet considered to be fully developed, and an alternative called Babbage is still in an early stage. So Solidity is nearly without alternatives. A code example may serve to clarify the language problem at contract conclusion. How shall parties understand this code? In principle, the contract language may be freely selected. It can be Latin and also be a programming language. In a German trial, source code must be provided in the German language. An expert would have to translate the code. But the real problem is that the contracting parties do not see this source code immediately. In the Ethereum blockchain, they see only the Ethereum bytecode. If they do not want to sign blindly, they must look up the source code on other servers before making a transaction related to this contract. The strength of decentralized smart contracts lies in the coordination of many different interests. Smart contracts are thus predestinate for the construction of public companies. But the ideas of the Ethereum community seem to go even further, suggesting options for a government organization of the blockchain. The platform provider Aragon has developed the first models of electronic arbitration. If Ethereum were to establish itself as a global standard, parts of the private law would be based on it in the medium term. The Ethereum blockchain concept was first described in 2013 and 2014 by Vitalik Buterin and Gavin Woods. The platform was developed by the Ethereum Foundation in Zug, Switzerland, with $18 million from a Bitcoin crowdfunding campaign. Only 3 years later, the market capitalization of Ethereum's own settlement unit amounted, Ether, it's called Ether, to $31 billion. And it's still rising, $31 billion in the mid of October, this October. Smart contracts are considered closely linked to blockchain technology. This close connection can be historically justified. The most common smart contract is found in the Bitcoin blockchain. The reward of currently 12.5 Bitcoins for solving certain calculation tasks is a smart contract in the form of a reward. However, smart contracts do not necessarily require a blockchain. It is only required in two functions: for the certification of decentralized contracts and for automated execution. A most recent legal definition of the blockchain is found in the civil procedural law of the state of Vermont. According to that, blockchain technology means a mathematically secured chronological and decentralized consensus ledger or database, whether maintained via internet interaction, peer-to-peer network, or otherwise. In view of the time, we should not go into much depth, but only recall three core characteristics. Basically, the blockchain is nothing more than a chain of entries, similar to a journal. The property and asset order is described in it by a transaction chain. If there would be nothing else, or no control over the entries, the benefit of the blockchain would not be greater than that of a distributed Excel spreadsheet. However, only correct information may be entered. Correct is information that is consistent with all previous entries. asset allocation must therefore be completely traceable up to the first entitled person. This creates the conditions for good faith. Each transaction contains information about the previous transaction, the sender, and the recipient. At each registration, the transactions are verified, added to a block, and completed with a timestamp. The second central feature of the blockchain is its protection against changes. Each block contains an encrypted summary of the previous block. This concatenation protects the blockchain against changes of individual blocks. The large amount of work involved in calculating new blocks protects against changes of a cascade of blocks. The proof of work model used was originally developed to deter denial of service attacks and other service abuses such as spam on a network by requiring some work from the services, some of the service requester. This technology relies on computational effort and is associated with immense power consumption. The security concept ensures that only about every 10 minutes a block is created. This protects a number of blocks from major changes, but also limits performance and scalability. For this reason, it has been worked on alternatives in the form of proof of stake model for some time now. However, it is not considered to be safe enough. The blockchain is a peer-to-peer network without a central management office. The participants of the network are full nodes, and everyone keeps a full copy of the ledger. This technology is currently setting limits in many respects. Only about 2 transactions per second can be processed worldwide. A transaction is only recorded after about 10 minutes. A block can only take up a limited amount of data. And the performance decreases with each newly recorded participant. Nevertheless, the technology is surprisingly attractive for new business models. Smart contracts and blockchain are discussed with various business models connected to finance, industry, and legal services. I want to flash a few briefly. In general, the prerequisites for the application of smart contracts are clearly defined services and service modalities. Furthermore, the prerequisites for the execution and the execution itself should be digitally verified or digitally processed. These requirements can be met more or less effectively with applications from the sharing economy. Existing business models such as car sharing can be further developed. In the field of renewable energies, crowdfunding can be combined with sharing concepts. Smart contracts can also be used to implement decentralized development platforms that connect an open group of developers with an open group of clients and licensees. The conclusion of the contract, as well as the billing of license fees, can be carried out cost-effectively and automatically. Smart contracts in insurance contracts are an obvious application where loss events can be digitized. Smart contracts promise efficiency gains. However, as with the recently offered flight delay insurance, they can also indicate the dispensability of insurances. Less obvious are the advantages of blockchains when issuing bonds. Consortium loans and export financing may justify the use of decentralized smart contracts, but the efficiency gains have yet to be proven. The blockchain hype is most clearly visible in crowdfunding, where the financing of new blockchain technologies is in the foreground. That business model proves to be a self-referential system. In contrast, the decentralized autonomous organizations model, which raises capital against the issuance of tokens, has proved to be a serious alternative to attracting venture capital. Admittedly, the legal nature of the tokens in question and the resulting diversity of apparent cryptocurrencies necessarily called the first regulators on the scene. A prudent regulation in crowdfunding could create a sensible and reliable opportunity for start-up financing in decentralized autonomous organizations. That's a real chance for smart contracts and blockchain technology. smart contracts are first and foremost subject to private law. Only when the legal order has been clarified, the question of the regulation will arise. It has often been disputed that smart contracts themselves represent a contract. This is related to the question of how they are concluded. For simple rule-based smart contracts, the vending machine provides a suitable model. But a special feature of the blockchain is, of course, that the person setting up the machine is not personally identifiable. But that is not even necessary. The deal comes about mediated by the smart contract with whom it is concerned. In the public blockchain, the contracting parties do not normally care about the actual contracting party. Trust is not placed in the party. It is placed in the contract and in its self-executing power. This is not so clear with intelligent smart contracts whose actions do not follow simple rules because they are self-learning or contain optimization algorithms. However, even these contracts could be concluded without the auxiliary constructs of the electronic person or an analogous application of the right of representation. The creator must always allow the actions of the smart contracts to be attributed to him. Where the originator cannot be determined, the contracting party must seek its trust in the contract itself. The conclusion of a contract in traditional written form is only necessary where the law of the general terms and conditions, AGB-Recht, legal form requirements, or supervisory law prohibits the immediate commencement of a smart contract. And it is not impossible to implement vague legal terms, assessments, and principles in smart contracts. On the contrary, smart contracts could even be particularly suitable for carrying out weighting processes and solving optimization problems. But, as suggested in literature, legal provisions must be integrated into the contract as a program library, and it is also necessary to implement reverse processing options, especially where contract partners are unknown. I have to skip some exciting questions in view of the time, but would like to ask something about basic questions regarding blockchain. There are a number of legal issues that only arise in the public blockchain. The data protection restrictions may be overrated. A peer-to-peer network cannot, of course, legally fail because it is not possible to identify a responsible party to whom a decision can be sent. The probative force of the blockchain can be represented in German law by the Institute of Prima Facie Evidence, Anscheinsbeweis. A real legal challenge is the transfer of tokens if they do not qualify as absolute rights because they are neither material nor intellectual property rights. Only the construction of a claim against all participants of the blockchain remains. There are some areas of law where regulation needs to be adapted to technical possibilities and new business models. Beyond the proposals that have already been discussed, it is worth considering investment law, which so far has required the involvement of a custodian bank to protect investors. Its traditional confidence-building function could merge into the blockchain. There's a particular need for clarification in banking and capital market law and data protection law. The limitation of automated decision according to Article 22, General Data Protection Regulation, on the other hand, does not constitute a barrier to the use of smart contracts. The relationship between the code and law, which has gained widespread attention with the DAO hack, deserves its own lecture. In my opinion, the purpose of a contract can be implemented in smart contracts. Where this is not possible, the proposal of an interface for external arbitrators should be considered. In both cases, the priority of the code should be maintained without loss of fairness and legal certainty. outside the smart contract, it's very difficult to track rights arising from performance disruptions. An exception to this are blockchains in which the partners know each other, but even there, it is better to map the disruption of performance law in the smart contracts themselves. As long as smart contracts are not in a position to adapt to changing legal and actual conditions, they should have an interface that allows adjustment from the outside. Smart contracts and blockchain technologies replace trust in people and institutions of law by trust in technology. This has an impact on the legal services market. The perpetuation function of notarial certification and the function of good faith in public registers may be wholly fulfilled by the blockchain. Utilities, settlement coin, and Everledger extend these functions to movable objects. Banks will become less important in payment transactions, lending business, and also in their function as trustees. This fate may also be shared by trustees, lawyers, and auditors. Traditional state dispute resolution mechanisms and private arbitration tribunals could be supplemented in part by smart contracts. They might be faster and cheaper. However, state courts will always have to remain the last instance. A decentralized smart contract will be implemented regularly across national borders. The individual national legal system can be integrated by means of program libraries. However, the cheapest way is to have a uniform law. It is questionable how the use of new technologies will change the competitive position of German law. It is to be assumed that the legal systems in which the developers are based will gain influence. The new technologies will also have an impact on the labor market and the qualifications required of lawyers. A study by Deloitte has seen a greater spread of the necessary competences. Traditionally, trained lawyers may be replaced by computer scientists. But there will also be new working areas for lawyers. A major challenge will be the legal and formal review of smart contracts and the ensuring of the security of the blockchain. Someone has to look after smart contracts and to control that they only do what they shall do and that they not do what they shall not do. New methods of contract drafting and contract review have to be developed here. This also results in new legal services. Finally, smart contracts and blockchain, like other areas of automation of the law, place new demands on the education of lawyers and law. Most universities have recognized this development. At some universities, specialized seminars and doctoral research colleges have already been established in which lawyers and computer scientists work together. In Ulm and Heidelberg, a doctoral college on digital law has recently been established. We are intensively researching individual questions on smart contracts and blockchain. And also against that background and my research interests, I'm looking forward to your questions and the discussions. Thank you for your attention. I'm a private lawyer, so to me, first of all, the interests of the parties are important. So, and the national law is a kind of a framework for that. So I think you have to adjust the smart contract to the national law, but I think also that you are able to form the national law too, as we do it at the moment too, in our private law. So I think that it's possible to implement national law and program libraries and to implement the framework of the national law into a smart contract. And I think also that it's possible to adjust the smart contract dynamically through these program libraries.
Is your understanding that the smart contract is the actual contract?
Yeah.
And would that mean that using a bug in the contract is legal, as it happened with Ethereum?
Well, I think that the DAO hack is more complicated than we think. It seems to be a fault in the compiler of Solidity. And if you see something like that, I think we need. I think the best thing would be to implement something in the contract, so it is immune against such errors. So it has a self-healing function or something like that, or a function that allows a reset in such cases. And if you don't have such things, I have sympathies with the proposal in the literature that we need an interface for courts to interrupt in those contracts. But we shouldn't open the door too wide, because if we do that, the advantages of smart contracts, the self-execution function and all those things would suffer. Yeah?
Did I understand your philosophical model of the smart contract correctly? So there is no guarantee function of the parties anymore, but the contract itself is the guarantee element, the guarantee
I think that's the only thing that works. If you don't know who's the party, you trust in the contract. That's the idea of smart contracts. You trust in the contract. And you have to search or trust where you left it. And that's the contract. Another idea is to see the whole blockchain community as an unregistered association, ein nicht rechtsfähigen Verein. Mm-hmm. So that's the only thing I could imagine. And I thought about that, if you think how to transfer tokens, that's not that easy. What's the legal concept behind the transfer of bitcoins? They aren't material, they aren't immaterial rights. If they are a right, you need a party, yeah? And it only can be those association, or this association, I think. But I would search the trust in the contract. Well, the idea is that it enforces itself. So it's like the gumball machine. Yeah, you put the coin into the gumball machine. You pull the button or something like that, and step by step, you can't get the coin out of it. Some people remember their childhood. Some children tried to get the coin out after getting the chewing gum, but it's not that easy. And I think that's the enforcement. Yeah. That's a similar question than the
you don't have a legal contract, if you have a smart contract. A smart contract is just, you know, something happens if you do this and that. That's the code, basically, you know, which you know, then follows a certain process.
But don't we have the same problems in traditional law, too? I bought a car, I pay created, and 1 year later, I discovered that the car hasn't all the properties I'd thought it has. So I tried to get my money back, but now I have to enforce it. I have to search my trust in the other party. And the same problem I have now in the smart contract. And I think we should implement default rules into the smart contract. And as long as that is not possible, we need an interface. I think that's your idea too, an interface so a court or another institution could interrupt in that, or could go into the smart contract.
I'll leave it at that. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot to
discuss.
Yeah.
I think the two. Yeah.
If the algorithm is the smart contract itself, mm-hmm. and so it's not the natural language wording mm-hmm. of the contract, mm-hmm. there's no interpretation possible because the algorithm is a determined system of signs. And so this is mm-hmm. the trust you have in your smart contract
yeah.
because it's determined. So, but this is other kind of language.
That's
the
idea.
Of contracts in normal way is the natural language. So the problems we have with the natural language is probably a benefit to have an interruption of a contract which has some problems, you know, and mm-hmm. so you can discuss it at the court. This is my problem.
But I think that we could implement weak elements in smart contracts too. So some discretion or some, I think that's possible. But perhaps it's an advantage of smart contracts that no discretion is in it.
But you have to formalize mm-hmm. the real world into these fuzzy logical systems.
Mm-hmm.
And this formalization process is a big problem we had in the 70s. And so this is the problem why in the 70s informatics and law
yeah.
had a problem with it.
But that's the reason why smart contracts are that interesting for the freer of law, yeah?
that's true.
Okay. okay, please. No, I don't think that. I think of those DAOs and all those crowdfunding projects, they are investors, and I think that's people as you and me. And if I'm not happy with my investment, I would go to a lawyer near my house, yeah, and would ask him, yeah, what's of this contract? And now I would confront this lawyer with a code in Solidity. And so it could be, I think it could be a topic for small law firms too.
So because it's more near to the
or sharing economy, if you think I get into a smart contract by using a car in a car sharing network. So, and if there are any problems, I will consider a lawyer of my trust. Yeah. That's useless.
car sharing.
Yeah. Estonia, and they have a lot of they have a digital driving license, they have a digital ID, and they try to get all their law into EU law, And so it might happen that it comes to Germany too. And to me, it's necessary to do some research on that. Yeah? So I think we could get that situation.
I agree, absolutely. I mean, we have to confront it and see how that develops. But defined elements of German law, you know, like Willenserklärung, you know, they have to imagine all that. And you don't need to have to look into the algorithm, for instance, all that. And if you find those matching declarations, then you're there. You don't need software for that. Mm-hmm. And that's how like a judge would look at that, or a lawyer would look at that to really solve the problem if there is a default. It's what is the intention of the parties and what have they declared. And it's not a smart contract, but it's algorithm because nobody really understands how it works.
Yeah, I see. Are we not tight, or? Perhaps we could talk together after that. So thank you.
I'm sorry for interrupting. Thanks to Professor Anzinger for this interesting and very informative presentation. I'm sorry that some of you had to stand in the last row. I informed my colleagues, and we will bring some more chairs to this room, so it will be more seat opportunities here. Now we will take a lunch break. Please enjoy our gourmet catering, and see you back at 2 with our next great speaker.